Greetings, unsettled souls, and welcome to The Correct Views. Sam IB DeGangi going live here. The live people right there, for some reason, I am just having a nightmare with this computer. There we go. Hello, everyone. It's not so much the computer, I should say my internet connection's dreadful tonight. So it's also going to be posted live. It's the post Labor Day show, because I knew nobody was going to tune in on Labor Day. That's why I'm doing a post Labor Day show. So before I start it, let us start. I got my Dead Kennedy shirt on. You know what that means, everyone, right? Yeah, I would hope you do by now. It means that we have special working man's music before we get into the nuts and bolts of it. Oh yeah, kill the poor. Indeed, it's my music for post Labor Day. It's the working man's show. It's going to be a rather alarming show, unfortunately. So now that I've got myself red flagged for copyright violation, we'll begin the show. Which is great, because Jello Biafra would be incredibly against that, oddly enough. Labor Day 2015, Joe Biden says he's for the workers. The reason that this is so funny is it damn near got the Dumpty of the Month. And we're going to be doing the Dunce Cap of the Month Thursday, by the way. This is the idiot that has been responsible for free trade, NAFTA, and everything that has destroyed the jobs of the average working man. This guy comes in like a bomb saying that he is for the workers. That's like Hitler saying he's for the Jews. It doesn't make any damn sense. Obama's vice president told union members on Labor Day that he supports the middle class and a level playing field on wages and the standard of living. Joe Biden. This is Joe Biden that said this. The paragon of the working man. Never mind the fact that the country is in such worse shape than ever before, in large part due to him. No, that's absolutely irrelevant. Doesn't matter in the least. He's the one that's for the poor. This article's written by Kurt Nemo. He said that a level playing field doesn't exist, which is amazing to me. Coming, again, from the man who is responsible for there not being a level playing field. I'm getting another delay here, and I'll tell you what, friends, I have no earthly idea why. You built the middle class, said Joe Biden during the annual Labor Day parade in Pittsburgh. I was in Pittsburgh the day before that. I'm glad I missed it. That's not an exaggeration. As you've declined, the middle class has declined. Build labor, we build America. Build labor, and we build the middle class. So you are the middle class, and as the middle class declines, then the middle class declines. That's what this bonehead just said. You built the middle class. That's not an exaggeration. As you've declined, the middle class has declined. That is the stupidest sentence I've ever heard from the guy that caused that sentence to even be made. The audience, primarily consisting of labor union members, cheered and urged Biden to get into the presidential race. Run, Joe, run, they chanted. Biden, however, is no friend of labor. He voted for NAFTA during the 103rd Congress in 1993. That is right around the time that all of this outsourcing came to do us in now, isn't it? NAFTA was designed by the elite and the political class to toss American workers and the globalist labor market and force them to compete with Chinese workers, earning on average about $4,755 per year, and Mexican workers making $7,668 annually. In Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand, and Malaysia, the annual wage is far lower. The annual wage in Vietnam, where manufacturing jobs are now flourishing, by the way, was $1,890 in 2013. So that's what we're competing against. That's where our jobs are going, thanks to Biden, who's on the side of the working man. It is interesting that a crowd of labor union members would cheer a man who helped permanently transfer a million manufacturing jobs out of all 50 states, the District of Columbia, and Puerto Rico. Sorry to gulp in your ear. So thirsty. Friends, a million jobs have been lost on this bonehead's watch, and he wants to be president. Moving on, ABCnews.com. go.com. Judge New York Town's Labor Day law is unconstitutional. A federal judge has struck down an unconstitutional and suburban New York Town's law banning day laborers from soliciting for work on public sidewalks, declaring its broad application could affect children selling lemonade in their driveway. U.S. District Court Judge Dennis Hurley said in a ruling Thursday that Oyster Bay's law violates the First Amendment. So at least some of these stories are real small. So at least we do have a little bit of good news coming from some of these judges. FoxNews.com, Obama to require paid sick leave for federal contractors. I've heard a lot of people talk badly about this. I don't have a problem with it because they are federal contractors. They are hired by the federal government. And they get sick too. And do I think that the federal government spends too much money? Yeah. Do I think they should hire less people? You bet I do. But that doesn't mean that the people that we do hire needs to be thrown under the bus. So this doesn't really outrage me as much as most of what Obama does. President Obama will mark the Labor Day holiday, and he did, Monday by signing an executive order requiring paid sick leave for employees of federal contractors, including 300,000 who currently receive none. The White House wouldn't specify the cost to federal contractors to implement the executive order, which Obama was to address at a major union rally and breakfast in Boston. Now, see, that angers me. It's always the power of the pen, always. No vote, just executive order. Do you know executive orders were supposed to be so that, first ladies' wives, I think it was Washington, his wife wanted some flower pots, and he signed an executive order that she could get these flower pots for her garden. They were little things that you would need while just working around the White House, because it is obviously a business headquarters as well. It was never meant to be used for the kinds of things that you're seeing today from our recent presidents. The Labor Department said any cost would be offset by savings the contractors would see as a result of lower attrition rates, increased worker loyalty, but produced nothing to back that up. Well, I mean, obviously a healthy worker is a better worker. That's not such a bad news. It really isn't. It's just the way he did it. Listen, under the executive order, just, you know, him writing something as if he was king, employees working on federal contracts gain the right to a minimum of 1 hour of paid sick leave for every 30 hours they work. I'm not against that. I'm sorry. It's stretched out over 12 months. That's 7 days a year. I mean, what? That's a good flu. 7 sick days of paid leave. I have no problem with that. That's fine. Hire less people. That's fine, too. PostGazette.com, speaking of Pittsburgh, Surveillance Society, a state lags in privacy protection laws. Did you know that Pittsburgh and Pennsylvania as a whole are one of the least constitutionally sound governments systems in the United States of America, which is odd, considering that so much of what is the Constitution? So much of what we call liberty comes from here. If your boss calls you into a corner office and demands your Facebook password, you can refuse with impunity in 23 states, though not in Pennsylvania. And I've covered this before. I don't have a Facebook account. I shut it down because they kept changing the name of the show. But the way to get around that, of course, is to have your regular Facebook page and then the Facebook page that isn't really you at all. It's just the lie that you're going to give to your employer. Do they deserve to be lied to? Yeah. If they want your password, you don't deserve to have to give your password up. So why give them a bit of truth? Just open two accounts. A state with individualistic roots running from the Declaration of Independence to the Whiskey Rebellion isn't among the nearly two dozen bar employees from insisting on access to your personal social media account. Similarly, Pennsylvania has no law governing the information stored in new cars' event data recorders, called the black boxes, no restriction on the flow of student data through education technology websites, that sounds nice and safe, and no rules for many other existing or potential surveillance tools now regulated in other states. I love how the feminists will come out here freaking out over and over and over again about the rape culture, which we've gone over does not exist. However, when something does come up that could potentially get somebody raped, like this constant surveying and storing of personal information to get hacked, when that happens, the feminists are nowhere to be found. I don't know how that happens. It doesn't make any sense to me. Privacy Journal, a Rhode Island-based publication that has been monitoring protections on personal information for 40 years, puts Pennsylvania in the fourth of five tiers of states. That means that you're not progressive in this area. You have not been watchful of these concerns that people legitimately have. And this is Robert Ellis Smith, the publisher of Privacy Journal. The legislature has not been on top of some of these concerns that other states have clearly legislated. Well, this is another way of seeing it. Perhaps state legislators aren't the right people to guide the international data industry, and Pennsylvania has been more prudent than, say, California. If you're going to be interested in having general standard for how tech companies serve the 50 states can provide a choice or a certain kind of security, those rules are best done nationally, said Jules Polensky, executive director of the Future of Privacy Forum, which pushes for industry self-regulation. The states certainly have a role to play, he added. Legislatures could tell their school districts to hire privacy officers to protect student information and to front the money to cover their salaries, he said. This year, Pennsylvania legislators have introduced numerous bills related to privacy, but they languish in committee. We are the cradle of liberty, we like to say in Pennsylvania, and that's true, said Senator Andrew E. Dinneman, Democrat Chester. Thus, when we have questions that involve the erosion of privacy and personal liberties, we should be able to, in the leadership in this area, based on our heritage. Well, then how in the world could he possibly be a Democrat? Because they've been horrible for privacy rights. Listen to this. Not a privacy keystone. States have long been the first responders to technology's encroachments, and Pennsylvania was once the leader. In state capitals, as compared to Washington, D.C., lobbying is sometimes much less intense, and public interest legislation is able to get through, Smith said. Pennsylvania has the nation's strongest law restricting the recording of phone conversations without both party consent, but in the past 15 years, the Keystone State has become laggard. Some states prohibit stores of selling affinity card data, demand that businesses encrypt personal data before emailing it, that's to make sure it doesn't get hacked in transit and your credit card is lost, require that companies post privacy policies online or restrict the collection of biometric information. Pending bills in other capitals would regulate smart TVs and other minors the right to be forgotten from their old social media provides on demand. In other words, spying in all kinds of crazy ways are perfectly legal in Pennsylvania. The cradle of freedom has become the cradle of communism, socialism, and New World Order spying. Friends, you're listening to The Correct Views. I thought this was going to be a long show. It may be a little bit shorter than normal, oddly enough. I want to give out, though, Sticker Junkie. Why am I asking you to go there? Because they sponsor the show. Yes, they do. Guess what else they do? They make amazing stickers. David Lake, TheMediaSpeaks.com. This show is a member show of The Media Speaks. And these passing time stickers that I'm showing you, David Lake did them. That's true. And if you get a hold of Sticker Junkie and let them know that you heard about it from The Correct Views, then you're also going to get a discount on your stickers, and they're going to look amazing. I want to ask you to look up the work of Mike McLaughlin, M-A-C-L-A-U-G-H-L-I-N. You can find him on Facebook, and he's a writer. He's a political commentator. He's definitely somebody you're going to want to go ahead and read. Let him know you heard about it from The Correct Views. Friends, humanity's big fight, the corporate ownership of food and water. From GMOs in our food to extracting all of the water, listen to this. Speaking of our working man's show here, the average working man, the average Joe Stiff, as it were, isn't entitled to, you know, drinking water that's under his own land. Listen to this. Christina Sarich, InfoWars. Privatization and corporate ownership of our food and water is what is at stake. The greed that has allowed companies to create patents on food and to siphon off water and sell it back to the world is as disturbing as ever. Following are ways in which the cabal is trying to control two of our most basic needs, food and water. So please pay attention to this, the overtaking of our food supply. A cabal controls our food supply. If you haven't heard about the massive Svetlana doomsday seed bank that individuals and companies like Bill Gates, Monsanto Corporation, Syngenta Foundation, and the government of Norway have created, then you might want to check it out. The seed bank seems to foreshadow a massive food crisis on this planet. By infiltrating our government regulatory agencies and lying about the safety, and there's links all through the article to source this, lying about the safety of genetically modified food that would be GMOs, our world's food supply is now in critical danger. Obama has passed Monsanto-friendly legislation, and with a trans-Pacific partnership being negotiated behind closed doors, and we all have talked about how that's going to lead to a further impoverishment of the nation, it's likely that our ability to decide against GMO labeling or bans as states will be retracted by the federal government. Do you realize the Trans-Pacific Partnership is hiding things that you're not even allowed to know that's in it as it's voted into law? Things that would allow things like, you know, I don't know, your food and water rights to be taken from you? Do you understand this? GMOs have been linked to cancer, with the World Health Organization now finally admitting that glyphosate, the main herbicide manufactured to be used in concert with these crops, is probably carcinogenic. That would mean causing cancer for you Kesher fans. The Institute for Responsible Technology reports how GMOs pose a risk to reproductive health, accelerated aging, and problems with our digestive system by damaging our healthy gut flora. You can also take probiotics to replenish a lot of that. In the same manner that the cabal's banking system, which you have read about in part one if you followed this series, it strips the common man and woman of their inherited wealth. Poor nations have become a testing ground for GMOs. Even places like Hawaii, called ground zero for GMOs, are also especially appealing to the biotech arm of the cabal, since the U.S. government is complicit in pushing this toxic food, and since the islands have a year-round growing season due to the perfect weather and daily rain. These crops not only spoil our current food, but they deplete the soil. What's more, they cross-pollinate thousand-year-old native crops, which were already good at defending against pests, weeds, and drought. Under the food topic, I will also include the pharmaceutical arm of the cabal, though it is no place here. But they are also inextricably linked that I may combine them. Monsanto, arguably the most influential company controlling the food supply, spun off into Pfizer, one of the biggest drug deal cartels on the planet. Americans consume half of the world's pharmaceuticals, and now only 5% of the world's population are accounted for there. This is no mistake. Part of the reasons Americans are so drugged and doped is because the same companies that control our food supply also control our healthcare system, the government agencies that regulate them, which would be the CDC, the FDA, the EPA, etc. Again, things that Ron Paul had said, what, he's been running for president off and on forever. He's not this year. His son is getting schlacked instead, unfortunately. Get rid of these. They're hurting us. They're not helping you. Controlling the water. California is going through the worst drought that it's ever seen, with a burgeoning 40 million population. Some might think that it's no wonder that they are suffering, having built their infrastructure in the middle of an extremely arid climate. But there is more to the story than this, and many of you don't know this. California should never be inhabited to the degree that it is. Historically, it's always been a drought-ridden, desert-prone area. It's only been the last recent 50-100 years that you've seen California look like that. It was an awful place to build. Corrupt corporations are making a killing off of California's drought. Nestle, I really have been pulling off Nestle. Every time I see Nestle in the news, that's something crappy. They're really, really an evil company. Listen to this. Nestle's actions are especially despicable. The company is drawing an unnumbered amount of water, likely millions of gallons of water, from the underground spring and then selling it back to the public. The company's CEO even recently said on a radio show that he would increase if he could, referring to the revenues gained from the water privatization. In other words, stealing your water and selling it back to you. Nestle has said that water is not a human right. No, even it's under your property. This is just a small example of the worldwide water privatization aims. The World Bank wants water privatized, go figure, and so do many corporations with a stake making gazillions off the world's thirst. And you can say drink rainwater, but drinking rainwater after Fukushima is a death sentence as well. Since nature gives water to us free of cost, buying and selling it for profit violates our inherent right to nature's gift and denies the poor of their human rights. This is from activist Vandana Shiva, thankfully. The sustainable use of water is never discussed by these companies, nor the fact that desalinization technologies already exist, which could make places like California an utter oasis. And again, taking the salt out of water was extremely expensive just 30 years ago. It's not as bad now. Look it up. It's in the article. What to do about the oligarchy? So what can you do? Well, listen to what InfoWars has here. The fact that you are reading this article and educating yourself is a big step in the right direction. As the world awakens to the atrocities that are being committed right under our nose, and as I've said, right under your house, we will free ourselves from tyrannical corporate control. According to Mahatma Gandhi, the only tyrant I accept in this world is the still small voice within me. Guys, we got three more to get to here on the average working man's Labor Day stories. I want to ask you if you could, though, to make sure that you donate to the show if you can at thecorrectviews@hotmail.com. Every penny you give to me goes towards a better show, and the cameras, all of that, the research, time and money, I appreciate every penny. Zero Hedge, 698,000 native-born Americans lost their job in August. Why this suddenly is the most important jobs chart. You're going to want to see it. The chart's up at Zero Hedge. Prison Planet had it linked ever so briefly. They might still be there. That's not on their main page is what I mean. After the Fed admitted over a year ago that the U.S. unemployment rate, which in 2012 was supposed to be a rate hike threshold, once hit the 6.5 and is now at just 5.2, has become irrelevant in a country where a record 94 million people have left the labor force. That means if you're not looking for a job, you're not considered unemployed. Even if, you know, you looked for one and couldn't find one and just stopped looking, you don't count. Well, now the Fed's poised to hike rates even though U.S. hourly wages have not increased for the past 7 years. But for the vast majority of the labor force that continues to decline, some have asked, is there any labor-related chart that really matters anymore? And the answer, he says, is a resounding yes. Only it's none of the conventional charts, none of the lies you get from the mainstream media. The one chart that matters more than ever, that has to do nothing with the Fed's monetary policy, but everything to do with the November 2016 presidential election, in which the topic of immigration, both legal and illegal, is shaping up to be the most rancorous, contentious, and divisive. The chart in the following is showing the cumulative addition of foreign-born and native-born workers added to U.S. payrolls, according to the BLS, since December of 2007. And it's since the start of the recession and the second Great Depression. The chart shows that in just the month of August, there will be enough to provide the Trump and every other campaign with enough sound bites and pivotal points to last for weeks. Namely, that in August, a whopping 698,000 native-born Americans lost their job. This drop was offset by 204,000 foreign-born workers who got a job. In other words, 204,000 largely illegal people in the country saw an increase, while those born in the country, and don't call me racist, I mean of all colors, those born here, 698,000 lost their job. How's that? You want to know why Trump is surging? Why is it that nobody knows Rand Paul is alive? Because this issue right here. And again, I plan on voting for Rand in the primary, but I'm mark my words, I don't see him getting anywhere. He has no traction. He is attacking Trump instead of mentioning the things that they have in common. It's been an awful campaign, friends. Awful. Kurt Nemo wrote this too, InfoWars. Warren Buffett, some citizens don't fit into a market-based economy, so we send them to Afghanistan. Do you realize what this piece of human filth is actually saying? He's saying that the average soldier's life doesn't really matter as much as anybody else because really they're not that smart, not that important to the economy. So whatever happens to them, happens. Listen, Warren Buffett, the mega billionaire investor who is ranked one of the wealthiest people in the world, recently told Bloomberg TV There is a place for citizens who cannot find their way in a rigged crony capitalist system steered by the elite oligarchy. And this is from Zero Hedge. He quotes the Wizard of Omaha, as they call him. You want everybody educated to the potential. You want people to reach their potential. That still won't work for some people in highly developed market systems. That would be Wall Street rigging the game so that they can't possibly lose the too-big-to-fail banks. He goes on, if this were a sports-based system, you could give me a PhD in football and I would practice 8 hours a day and I might be able to carry water from not onto the field, but from the locker room to the bench. That's just some people don't fit well into highly skilled market-based economies. In other words, he's comparing the average soldier to the water boy in a football game while comparing people like himself to the football players, the elitists, the ones who are very good at making money on the backs of people like that. They're perfectly decent citizens. We'll send them off to Afghanistan, but we're not going to command a very big price. Friends, I'm about to swear. How does this evil, vile son of a bitch get away with saying something like that? There's nothing. Crickets. Nobody cares. Nobody cares at all. Nobody's called him out on this. Nobody's mentioned that he literally, should lose his backing from everyone the way they tried to do to Duck Dynasty. What that guy, bearded guy, said was nothing compared to what was just said here. Listen to this. In other words, according to Buffett, Americans' veterans are just short of being worthless, suitable for little more than serving as disposable pawns on the grand chessboard of American primacy and geostrategic imperatives, as arch globalist Zbigniew Brzezinski would have it. Henry Kissinger made a similar comment about Americans' veterans. He's another piece of scum. Bob Woodward and Carl Bernstein, in their book, The Final Days, write, Kissinger told General Alexander Haig, military men are dumb, stupid animals to be used as pawns for foreign policy. And the remark was never denied by Kissinger. All right, guys, and that brings us to, of course, the dumdy of the day. And now, you know what? I think I'm one ahead of myself here. We are actually not to the dumdy of the day yet. Hold on. I'm looking at this, and I want to get to this first. I'm going to cue the dumdy. How's that? We got our dumdy music already. How many of you were already? Nope, not happened yet. Let me highlight this. We'll get to it next. And I saw this today, and this is why I got ahead of myself. I added this and forgot to put it in order. This is from CNS News, Terrence P. Jeffrey. Government employees outnumber manufacturing employees 1.8 to 1. 1.8 to 1. Those employed by government in the United States in August of this year outnumbered those employed in the manufacturing sector almost 1.8 to 1, according to the data published by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. In other words, they have outsourced so much of our jobs at the same time that government has become mind-blowingly big that we literally now have more people with the federal government as their job, as their main job, than we do of any employee that we don't make anything. All we do is have a bunch of bureaucrats in our government telling everybody else what to do. And since the dumdy of the day is not going to load up because now it's telling me it's a dead link, I can go ahead and tell you what it was. The dumdy of the day, just look it up, Jeb Bush. Jeb Bush is out there saying we need 4 years of him to further strengthen the economy. Now, after the story I just gave you, here's the dumdy music. Further strengthen the economy. The economy is tanking. We need somebody to start strengthening the economy. Jeb Bush, dumdy of the day. Guys, we got the dunce cap of the month. That's going to be coming up for you on Thursday. Do me a favor, share this video far and wide. And thank you for listening, friends. It is the correct views. Make sure you look up the work of Kyle Court, D-Lake, and myself. TheMediaSpeaks.com. We're posting always and asking all of you to support us and share our videos. So thank you. Good night, friends. God bless.